Thanks for coming today. My name is Rebecca Taffel. I work with Elizabeth Sackler at the Foundation, the Elizabeth A. Sackler Foundation. And we work alongside with the Sackler Center staff here to provide additional programming here at the center. So I'm thrilled to welcome you all today here to hear Ann Kirschner speak about Josephine Marcus Earp, the focus of her most recent book, Lady at the OK Corral, The True Story of Josephine Marcus Earp. And thank you for coming on this beautiful fall day. For the past 6 years, the Elizabeth A. Sackler Center for Feminist Art has continued to fulfill its commitment to the past, present, and future of feminist art. Using its award-winning exhibition and education spaces, the Sackler Center strives to raise awareness of feminism's cultural contributions. Dialogue and debate about feminist art, theory, and activism take place here in the Sackler Center's forum, and groundbreaking exhibitions are held in its Feminist Art and Her Story galleries. Right now, currently on view, you can go see the Kathy Kollwitz prints from War and Death portfolios. We are currently installing our fall show, which is a solo show that features the work of the contemporary Brooklyn-based artist Wangechi Mutu. So I hope you'll come back for that when it opens. But the center is more than its gallery spaces. It's a place that celebrates open discourse, conversation, and the exchange of ideas. And that's sort of what Elizabeth Sackler envisioned for this space. She could not be here today, unfortunately, because of some ongoing health issues. But she asked me to let you know how delighted she is that Anne is here to join us today and to share her story of Josephine Earp, the woman who was Wyatt Earp's common law for nearly 50 years, the woman who sparked the world's most famous gunfight, and the woman who shaped the legend of Wyatt Earp and the Wild West. So just a little bit briefly about Anne. She is a writer and the University Dean of Macaulay Honors College at the City University of New York. She began her career as a lecturer in Victorian literature at Princeton University, where she earned a PhD in English. Her career as an entrepreneur in media and technology includes the creation of satellite and internet businesses for the NFL and Columbia University's online education company, Fathom. A frequent contributor to conferences and publications, Ann Kirschner was named one of New York Magazine's Millennium New Yorkers and honored as a distinguished graduate of Princeton University and the University of Buffalo. She serves on the board of directors of Apollo, Public Agenda, the Jewish Women's Archive, and Princeton University Graduate School Leadership Council. Besides Lady at the OK Corral, she is the author of Sala's Gift, published in 2006 by Simon & Schuster, the story of her mother's wartime rescue of letters from Nazi labor camps. And it's available in German, Polish, Chinese, French, and Italian editions. The original letters are in the permanent collection of the New York Public Library and are the subject of a traveling exhibit in the US and Europe, a theatrical play, Letters to Sala, by Arlene Hutton, and a documentary film, The Letter Carrier, by Murray Nussel. So without further ado, please help me welcome Anne Kirschner.
Thanks very much. I can't imagine a more fun and appropriate person to be, appropriate place to be than the Sackler Center today. I took a walk around Judy Chicago's dinner party, and really there's no more inspiring groups. With all due respect to our camera person, it's lovely to have an audience of women too. So what I'd like to do is just read you the first couple of pages of Lady at the OK Corral, and then take you on a little bit of a travelogue of some of the images around Josephine's life, and then maybe we can talk a little bit about this very unusual woman. So the opening to the book is called In Which I Land on Planet Earp. Did you know that Wyatt Earp was buried in a Jewish cemetery? Just hearing his name threw me back to my childhood in Jackson Heights, New York City, sprawled on the floor in front of a black and white television set watching Westerns with my big brother Joey, dressed up in his special shirt with braided trim and snazzy snap buttons and black cowboy hat and shiny gun in a faux leather holster slung around his hips. Joey and I tuned in and pretended to walk the streets of Tombstone every week together with millions of Americans, young and old. Joey was my hero, and Marshall Earp was his. Brave, courageous, bold, and Jewish. That was how it all started, just an innocent question from a friend who thought, correctly, that I would be intrigued by the incongruities between anything Jewish and anything Tombstone-ish. This first burst of curiosity about Wyatt Earp's final resting place in religion was easily satisfied. I learned that Wyatt, the only man to emerge unscathed from the gunfight at the OK Corral, was not Jewish, but had lived with a Jewish woman for nearly 50 years. She buried him next to her parents and her brother in a family plot at the synagogue-affiliated Hills of Eternity Cemetery outside of San Francisco. And that was my introduction to Mrs. Earp. So that is how it all started. And if you want to know what my brother Joey looked like with that faux holster, and I'm going to walk around. You can hear me okay, right? I'm going to walk around a bit, there's my brother Joey, and there's me. Isn't that a cute baby? And some of you may remember TV sets like that. And some of you may be able to sing the Wyatt Earp theme song.
Wyatt Earp,
Wyatt Earp. Sound familiar? I won't try and sing the whole thing to you, but I can guarantee you most of the time I talk to people, they really know about it. And when I started this book, I thought, well, this is as different from my mother's Holocaust story as you could possibly get. I'm back to the American West. But little did I know that as I began to figure out Josephine's family history, I was right back in Poland again. Because this is the area where Josephine was from, the province of Posen in Prussia, and right down here is where my mother was from. So that's the only thing Josephine and my mother have in common. My mother would want me to tell you that. She's 89, and whenever I go to give a talk, the first thing she says to me afterwards is, did anybody come? So she'll be very happy that you were here. But this is where Josephine's family was from. And her parents came from the province of Posen to New York around 1850. And Josephine was born in 1860 in New York. But her family did not prosper in New York. Her father was a baker. It was very hard for them to make a living. And if you were living in New York at that time and were reading one of the many, many Yiddish language newspapers that were in New York at the time, there were always letters from San Francisco. People from San Francisco were writing to people in New York through the newspapers saying, it's so exciting here, there's so much opportunity. And so a lot of Jewish immigrants did what the Marcus family did, was they had a second hop of immigration. They came to New York around 1850. Josephine was born in 1860. They spent the Civil War in New York, and then as soon as the Civil War was over and they were able to travel again, off they went to continue to seek their fortune, this time in San Francisco. And the only way to get there in those days was to go down the east coast of the United States. By the time they went, the Isthmus of Panama was open, so they were able to go through not the Panama Canal, but by railroad, and then back up the coast of California by steamer. And the reason this picture is of such interest to me is that when the San Francisco that they arrived in, so now it's about 1870, was a very exciting place. And the Jewish community in San Francisco was at least as well developed as the Jewish community in New York, and similarly stratified. So if you were a German Jew, chances are you belong to the upper class of the Jewish community in San Francisco. But if you were a Polish Jew, or from someplace other than Germany, you tended to be lower class, less affluent. You went to different schools, you went to different parties, and I think that's one of the secrets of the secret motivations behind what happened to Josephine. So here's the synagogue for the Germans, Temple Emmanuel, and here's the synagogue for everybody else. That was called Sheriff Israel. And this fellow is here because his name is Isaac Benjamin.
And he went traveling around the United States, visiting Jewish communities and then writing about them. And he wrote very much about the stratification of the Jewish and of the Jewish community, to the extent where if a Polish Jew was in need and the money for the charitable organizations was controlled by the Germans, they likely would not support the Polish Jew in time of need. So it was really, you know, a weird sort of form of anti-Semitism within the Jewish community. So Josephine, being a young and beautiful girl, and that's not Josephine, I'll tell you who that is in a minute. Josephine didn't want to be second class anything. She had a younger sister who was much more, did much better in school, was sort of a good Jewish girl in a way that Josephine was not. And she chafed at the restrictions in the community. And so when she was about 18 years old, she had been taking dancing lessons. And San Francisco was full of the news of the boom towns of the American frontier. And the Pinafore Society, there were Pinafore, HMS Pinafore rages throughout the United States. Every town had an HMS Pinafore troop. And Josephine was recruited by one of those to go off to the boom towns and do her little hornpipe dance as part of the cast of HMS Pinafore. She was recruited by an actress named Pauline Markham. And again, this is one of dozens of troops that were going out west. And so Josephine joined this group, went out to the west, and while she was there, and that may be Josephine, I'm going to tell you a little bit about that picture in a minute. While she was there, she caught the eye of a sheriff, and she thought, well, you know, this guy's pretty cool. His name was Johnny Bean, and he wanted to marry Josephine. And so when the performances ended, she went back to San Francisco, told her parents that she was going to go to this place called Tombstone to be with this man, Johnny Bean, and be his wife. Now, we know Josephine was wildly attractive, and we know that because of what happened to her later in life. But there were no verified pictures of Josephine as a young woman. These are two that are said to be Josephine. And I've had somebody who's a forensic expert look at these pictures as well as some of the others. And the best I can tell you is those might be Josephine, and you'll see a little bit of her later on, what she actually looked like later in life. But she goes off to Tombstone. She goes by train and by stagecoach. She ends up there, she ends up there, and this is Johnny Bean. She takes up with Johnny Bean. She's not married, but he says he's going to marry her. But it doesn't take long before Josephine realizes that Johnny Bean is a dirty dog. He has no intention of marrying her, and so she leaves him. And, you know, sometimes we talk about, I'm very inspired by being at the Elizabeth Sackler Center for feminist art. Sometimes we talk about if you could go back in history and live in any other time. What I've noticed is when that question is posed to men, there were times that they think it would be cool to go back and live again. But really, there were no other times for women when women had a lot of choices. And when you think about Josephine Marcus in Tombstone, after she's run away from home, she's an actress, not much of an actress. She comes to Tombstone to marry this guy, Johnny Bean, and he turns out to be a bad guy who's running around with all kinds of other women, including the prostitutes. What is Josephine going to do? She really doesn't want to go home again because she's going to go home and tell her parents she failed. Well, she meets Wyatt Earp. And Wyatt Earp and Johnny Bean undoubtedly knew each other. Tombstone was a very small place, and they were both lawmen with different jurisdictions. And here's Wyatt Earp. And if you have any doubt as to why Josephine was interested in Wyatt, there were probably many reasons, but surely among them was the fact that Wyatt Earp was drop-dead gorgeous. Wyatt Earp and his brothers were about 6'1", 6'2". The four of them were tall, rangy, big mustaches, flesh and blue eyes. I'm sorry, ladies, this was a very good-looking group of men. Now, Wyatt had come to Tombstone not long before, and he and his brothers all had common-law wives. It wasn't that uncommon at the frontier for men not to get, and women not to get legally married. There weren't that many people, you know, ministers, whatever, to legally marry them. It was just a much more informal time. So Wyatt's there with his common-law wife. This is Maddie Blaylock. He's got a lawman job. He's got a lawman job. And sometime during the year 1881, Josephine and Wyatt met and fell in love. So Wyatt at this point is cheating on his common law wife. This was, by the way, already his third wife, but be that as it may, Wyatt actually was, I believe, serially monogamous, as opposed to Johnny Bean. But all of this sets up the story of the gunfight at the O.K. Corral. And this was one of the things that really interested me in the story. The gunfight at the O.K. Corral, I have a Google alert on O.K. Corral, and every single day, usually several times a day, the O.K. Corral is evoked in one way or another. Sometimes it's about gun control. Sometimes it's about a basketball game. Sometimes it's about a congressional standoff. But the idea of the gunfight at the O.K. Corral really has deep roots in the American psyche. And we think about it as the story of the lawmen versus the cowboys, but it was actually much more complicated than that. And I'm not going to spend that much time talking about the gunfight, except to say that what no one ever talks about when they talk about the gunfight was that Johnny Bean was on one side of it, Wyatt Earp was on the other side of it, and both of them had been Josephine's lovers. So this is not only a story of, you know, all these good and evil issues that we talk about when we talk about the gunfight at the O.K. Corral, this was also a love triangle with Josephine and rival lovers. After the gunfight at the O.K. Corral, Wyatt was the only one who was unharmed, there were several legal battles right afterwards, and Wyatt set out to find the men who had tried to kill him and had in fact killed one of his brothers and almost assassinated the second one. And that's known as the Vendetta Ride. So the aftermath of the gunfight of the O.K. Corral lasted several months. During that time, Josephine did go home to San Francisco. The gunfight was a story everywhere in the world. As far as Australia, they were writing about the gunfight at the O.K. Corral. So I can only imagine what it's like for Josephine when she goes home to Mr. and Mrs. Marcus and says, well, I've left Tombstone, but now I have a new man in my life. You're going to meet him very soon. And in fact, in 1882, after Wyatt has killed about four other people, again, the aftermath of the gunfight at the O.K. Corral, he comes to San Francisco to pick Josephine up, and that was the beginning of the next 48 years that they spent together. This map will show you a little bit of where their adventures were. You can see most of them were in the West. But from 1882 until Wyatt's death in 1929, Josephine and Wyatt were rarely apart. And so for me, this was a rediscovery of the building of the American West, not only the western part of the United States, but even up there as far as San Francisco. Alaska. The most fun adventure I had, and we were talking a little bit about it before we began, was really in Nome, Alaska. Wyatt and Josephine had an incredible nose for adventure. They never lived in the same place for very long. They never owned a home. They were totally rootless. They never had children. Apparently, Josephine could not. So they just kept moving. And a lot of it was around here. But then, towards the turn of the century, when the Alaska Gold Rush began, they went up to Alaska as well. And over the course of 3 years, they became enormously successful in Alaska. Not so much from gold mining, but from what Wyatt called mining the miners. Being a saloon keeper, a gambler, and when they left San Francisco, they left with the equivalent of $7 million and really could have coasted for the rest of their life. But playing it safe was never in their vocabulary, so having made several fortunes, they continued on to pretty much spend it all. They spent most of their time during the winter in the California desert, and this is a bona fide picture of Josephine and their dog, Earpy, and their Wyatt Earp, and this is out in the California desert. I've actually gone out there, and it is totally in the middle of nowhere. And it really gave me insight into Josephine's character. On the one hand, she wants to be a lady. She wants to be sophisticated. On the other hand, she loved roughing it with Wyatt and was ready to match him adventure for adventure. And wherever he went, she was by his side. The frontier really shifted around 1910, 1920, and the real American frontier was replaced by the story of the American frontier, and that was really the birth of Hollywood. And the early Westerns, and here's Tom Mix and William S. Hart, they were all great friends of Wyatt's. That really became the place where the legend of Tombstone, the legend of Wyatt Earp, was shaped. And one of the many ways in which Josephine struck me as a thoroughly modern woman was this very modern sense of celebrity that she had. She didn't want Wyatt to be the bad guy who shot people up after the gunfight at the OK Corral. She wanted you to think of him as the guy with the white hat, the really good guy. And so as the story of Tombstone began to be told, she was very active in censoring it and shaping it wherever she could. And the greatest success she probably had was in the first big biography of Wyatt Earp, which was called Frontier Marshal. She very much shaped that story. It was a bestseller when it was published and has remained in print ever since. In fact, when in World War II, the author, Stuart Lake, met General Eisenhower and suggested that all the troops should be Frontier Marshal. All the GIs were reading this story. Wyatt, even to the end of his life, was that darn good-looking fellow. He's just about the only one from that era who lived to be 80 years old. Josephine, you know, she got a little dumpy, but very, very, very sweet face, and that picture of her really helped me to be able to authenticate some of the other pictures. And his death, as you can imagine, was the greatest tragedy of her life. This is a piece that was written by the doctor who was taking care of Wyatt Earp when he died. He was reading him a story about Tombstone when Wyatt actually died in 1929, which was a national news story. Again, Wyatt Earp was very famous in his own time. This was the telegram that Josephine sent to Stuart Lake, the one who wrote that first best-selling biography, telling him when the funeral was going to be. And the lineup of people, including William S. Hart and Tom Mix, who went to Wyatt's funeral, was really a story of the West. And so Wyatt's passing became very much a sense of what did the American frontier mean and what would be left of it in the future. Josephine lived on for 15 more years, and again, very much focused on Wyatt Earp's legend, that we should be thinking about him as a good guy. And she caught a very lucky break when Lincoln Ellsworth, who was an Arctic explorer, had read Frontier Marshal, was very interested in Wyatt Earp, and wrote to Josephine and said that he wanted to put a little shrine on the boat that was going to go to Antarctica, and he wanted to name his boat the Wyatt Earp. Josephine immediately seized the the romance of this, and gave Stuart Lake Wyatt Earp's last glasses and one of his shotguns and a couple of other things. And so Wyatt Earp, Lincoln Ellsworth went off to Antarctica, and you have no idea how big a story this was. I thought I had one more picture. The New York Times had hundreds of stories about Lincoln Ellsworth, and when he was lost at sea, which went on for several weeks, the front page of the New York Times continually was reporting on the whereabouts of this little ship, the Wyatt Earp. This is an era when, you know, Hitler is ascending to power, George V abdicates, doesn't matter, whatever it is, the Wyatt Earp continues to be a front page story. And so it renewed all of that sense of Wyatt Earp as a hero, as an American story, rugged individualism, freedom, exploration, all of that good stuff. Maybe it was the success she had with Lincoln Ellsworth, and here's Josephine over here, kind of looking like a prepper widow. She thought maybe it was time for her to tell her story. And I don't know if any of you are familiar with a book that I deeply love, Carolyn Hyland's writing, Women, very much about what women's biographies are all about and about the right of women to tell their own story. Having spent so much of her life trying to tell Wyatt's story, Josephine then thought, well, maybe it's time now for me to tell my story. She met some relatives of Wyatt's, these two women, and she commissioned a memoir that would be her memoir that she would be telling them about. But the closer they got to the real story of what happened in Tombstone, the more nervous she became. Not only was she very nervous about you finding out that she had been the lover of Johnny Meehan before she met Wyatt, but the real story that she was the most worried about was what happened to Wyatt's previous wife, Maddie Blaylock, after Wyatt left her for Josephine. She descended into prostitution, drug addiction, and eventually killed herself. And she died cursing Wyatt, that Wyatt had left her, and that she had nothing left to live for, and she killed herself. That was the story that Josephine most didn't want you to know. And so as the Earp relatives got closer to what had really happened, Josephine got more and more nervous until eventually she said to them, you know, we're not going to do this story. They went back with her to Tombstone while they were researching the story, but Josephine really, she couldn't take the risk. And so they burned the manuscript. She put a curse on it. She put a curse on anybody who would try to tell her story, which so far I have not seen the effect of, but I can tell you, my mother said, don't do this book, you know, Josephine will come get you. But I think, you know, we can talk about that later, when Josephine come and get me. And then towards the real end of her life, and this is 1943, and Josephine would be dead about a year later, she descended probably into dementia and began writing really angry and paranoid notes to all of Wyatt's old friends. She died in 1944, as opposed to Wyatt Earp's death, which was a national news story. Nobody paid a whole lot of attention to Josephine dying, although it was a story in the news. She was buried in that family plot, and it was the same plot outside of San Francisco that she had buried Wyatt in, and so there they sit now. And it's the most visited grave in the Hills of Eternity Cemetery in Colma, California. And, you know, I guess for me, the key story or the key takeaway is that this notion of the American frontier is a very deep one in our psyche. But how can you tell the story of the American West without understanding Tombstone, the Lawman, and Wyatt Earp? And how can you tell that story without restoring the women to the picture? Because for so many decades, you read these stories and there were no women, as if these men had no wives or lovers or mothers or sisters. So for me, the great joy of the story was really putting Josephine back in the picture, because I found her life so extraordinarily interesting. And with that, I'd like to see if you guys have any questions and tell you a little bit more about Josephine.
I have two questions about, actually, and one is that since I did not watch the early television shows, I really don't know what the gunfight at OK Corral was about. But then also, I was interested in whether she represented the pioneer spirit of that era that we read so much about, and that I'm a little bit familiar with, having come from out west, that women really have to overcome so much.
So much.
And so I was wondering if that was true for her. That's why I have two questions.
So so the first question about the gunfight at the OK Corral, Tombstone had two very different factions, even though it was such a small city. There were Democrats and there were Republicans. There were people who were ranchers, and some of those were involved in making sure that there was enough beef for the people to eat in Tombstone. And then there were the miners, who thought that everything should be to protect the mining interests. There were people who had had been involved on the representing the South during the Civil War, and there were those who had represented the North. So all of those were sort of different fault lines in, if you look at it from a historical or a thematic perspective. If you look at it from a personal perspective, these were guys who really didn't like each other. It was Wyatt and Johnny Bean who had, you know, this quarrel over Josephine. But then you had people who had gambling fights with each other, you know, just people who just plain hated each other. And all of that sort of boiled up over the course of months. So on this one day, on October 26, 1881, some of them were sort of hungover, and some of them had guns and they shouldn't have guns, and there was this confrontation, not actually at the OK Corral, but at a lot next to the OK Corral. So even the name is a little bit misleading. So that's the story of a gunfight, and three people were killed, and Wyatt then was seeking revenge. The second question is a more complicated question. You know, Josephine as a role model, Josephine representing the spirit of the West. You know, she wasn't the traditional American frontierswoman. I think it's a much more complicated story than that. The bottom line to me about the story of the American women is the ability to reinvent oneself. It's an immigrant story as well as an American story, and to that extent, I believe she really does represent the spirit of the American frontier. But it's, you know, it's more complicated than simply, you know, the stereotype of the American frontierswoman out on the ranch protecting the homestead and her children. Does that answer that?
Thank you.
Yeah. I'm particularly fascinated by her Jewish history. I noticed that a rabbi did her eulogy. Did she continue to practice her eulogy when she was out there?
She did not.
Nowhere?
She did not. Tombstone had an active Jewish community. It was called the Tombstone Hebrew Benevolent Association. Many of the little towns had Jews who were either working for the miners or the peddlers. There were active Jewish communities everywhere. Once Josephine left home, she really never actively pursued being Jewish at all. Even Nome had a Jewish community. And that was one of the things I found so interesting. She didn't deny being Jewish. Everyone knew she was Jewish, but she was kind of indifferent to it. It didn't animate her in any way. Wyatt had more Jewish friends than she did. So her identification as a Jew, she really sort of put on the back burner once she left home. The only place it came absolutely to the forefront was when she was trying to decide what to do with Wyatt's ashes. She returned to her Jewish community and buried him next to her parents in a Jewish cemetery. So, you know, so I learned more about the Jews of the American West and the Jews of Alaska, and again we'd be confronted by the reality that Josephine really kept herself separate from them. And one generation later, there were no Jews left in the family, although Josephine had no children, her siblings had children, and I've gotten to know quite a few of those.
You got to know them, huh?
Yeah, that part's been absolutely wonderful. The picture of Lincoln Ellsworth and the Wyatt Earp ship that's inscribed when Josephine came from Josephine's nephew, who lives out in California.
Cool.
Yeah, that part was a lot of fun.
Were Jewish people persecuted or separate at all in the frontier period that you're describing? Was there a distinction made?
The question of Jewish integration or discrimination in the West is a very interesting one. By and large, no. Jews were very, very well integrated into the business community, which isn't to say that there weren't, you know, anti-Semitic actions here and there, but by and large, they were very well integrated. The most brutal racism was really against Chinese people who had been brought in largely to work on the railroad, and African Americans. It was just tremendous discrimination against them, but I found very little against the Jews, especially in San Francisco. You know, I showed you the picture of the steamer coming into San Francisco Harbor. On the Jewish high holidays, they would stop the steamer service in San Francisco out of respect for the Jews of San Francisco, which, you know, it's kind of like stopping the subways in New York. We don't even do that in New York, and New York has got a very large Jewish population, so. I hope some of you will learn more about her, and I'm very grateful for your interest and tying her together with Elizabeth Sackler in this center is really a great joy for me. So thank you very much for coming.